Hi folks, I'm Dr. Jay Chapman. Today we're going to examine Guadalupe Mountains National Park and learn about reefs, carbonate factories, and the connection between Pangaea and the Persian Gulf. Guadalupe Mountains National Park in West Texas is an ancient reef like the modern Great Barrier Reef in Australia. The fossil reef is called Capitan Reef and was named after El Capitan, the prominent peak at the southern end of the Guadalupe Mountains. El Capitan shares a name with the famous cliff face in Yosemite National Park, but the geology between the two is dramatically different.
Oh, Captain, my Captain.
El Capitan in the Guadalupe Mountains towers about 600 meters above the valley floor. What's amazing is that this is pretty close to the relief of the reef above the seafloor during the Permian when the reef was forming. So looking up at the Guadalupe Mountains today from the entrance to the park is not too dissimilar from looking up at the reef from the bottom of the ocean 260 million years ago. The fossil reef is made up of the skeletons or shells of many types of organisms, including algae, sponges, bryozoans, brachiopods, and corals. The shells and skeletons of these organisms were mainly composed of the minerals calcite and aragonite. Aragonite is a polymorph of calcite, meaning it has the same chemical formula, calcium carbonate, but a different atomic arrangement. Aragonite's not very stable at Earth's surface, and it usually transforms into calcite during the lithification or fossilization process. All minerals that have a CO3 ionic group are called carbonates, and rocks that are made mostly of these minerals are also called carbonates. The main carbonate rocks are limestone, made of calcite, and dolostone or dolomite.
Dolomite is my name.
Made of the mineral dolomite.
Who? Dolomite.
A calcium magnesium rich carbonate. Carbonates and siliciclastics are the two main types of sedimentary rocks on Earth. Siliciclastic rocks like sandstone, shale, and conglomerate are made up of broken down fragments and pieces of other rocks and mainly contain silica-bearing minerals like quartz and feldspar. Carbonates can precipitate by inorganic processes, but the majority of carbonate rocks on Earth today, and especially limestone, are made up of the shells and skeletons of marine organisms. This is pretty obvious when there are fossil reefs preserved in the rock record, but it's less obvious when these calcite skeletal fragments are really small or get ground up into tiny microscopic pieces. Limestone can be produced almost anywhere there are calcite-producing organisms living in the water. But to get really thick layers of limestone, there needs to be a place pumping out lots of carbonate sediment.
Pump up the jam, pump it up.
These places are called carbonate factories, and the Capitan Reef system is a great example. It was such a productive factory because it formed in the perfect conditions, a relatively shallow, well-lit, warm tropical sea located just south of the equator, called the Permian Basin. The Permian Basin formed during the time of Pangaea, when all the continents were smushed together. The collision of the North American and South American plates during the formation of Pangaea created the Wachita Marathon Orogenic Belt. It's a southern extension of the Appalachian Mountains. The Wachita Marathon Belt is exposed in Arkansas, Oklahoma, Texas, Coahuila, and Chihuahua. The mountain belt pushed the North American plate down and created a flexural foreland basin. A modern analog of the Permian Basin is the Persian Gulf in the Middle East, where the Arabian and Asian plates are colliding. The Arabian plate is being flexed downward by the overriding Asian plate to form a foreland basin, and that basin is filled with seawater. The Permian Basin was divided into several sub-basins by a series of underwater promontories and narrow peninsulas. These peninsulas and promontories were actually large underwater mountains uplifted by reverse faults. Tectonically, these uplifts are likely analogous to the Laramide uplifts in Wyoming, like the Bighorn Mountains and Wind River Range. The sub-basin that Capitan Reef formed in is called the Delaware Basin, and is flanked by the Central Basin uplift to the east and the Diablo uplift to the west. The reef formed a narrow ribbon over 700 kilometers long that encircled the Delaware Basin where the water depths and temperatures were just right.
It's a bit like Goldilocks and the Three Bears.
Capitan Reef is exposed in the Guadalupe Mountains and a few other mountain ranges in West Texas, but is still mostly buried in the subsurface, where it's a major oil and gas reservoir and exploration target. Because of its importance to the oil and gas industry, as well as its exceptional exposure in the Guadalupe Mountains, the Capitan Reef system has been studied in detail for over a century. Geoscientists from all over the world make the pilgrimage to the park to learn about how reefs and carbonate depositional systems are expressed in the rock record. Carbonate depositional systems are composed of spatially adjacent depositional environments, just like clastic depositional systems. The most common depositional system is a carbonate platform or ramp that develops in shallow water on a continental shelf and consists of back reef, reef, fore reef, and basin facies. The back reef is usually a broad, shallow shelf composed of aeolian, tidal flat, and lagoon deposits. Carbonate sand shoals or bars may form, and small reef communities called patch reefs may be scattered about. The reef is the heart of this system, and it's where most of the carbonate sediment is produced. During large storms and when the reef is battered by waves, sediment falls off the reef and gets redistributed. On the back reef side, these reef fragments can be reworked by waves and form a carbonate sand apron. On the fore reef side, the fragments fall down the steep reef face into the basin and form an underwater talus slope. Far from the reef, in the middle of the basin, the only carbonate sediment produced is from plankton living in the water. The skeletal fragments of these microorganisms rain down to the basin floor.
I'm gonna make it rain.
And are so small that it makes a carbonate mud or ooze. The type of rock produced from this mud is called pelagic limestone. And it's usually pretty boring, often featureless and gray and difficult to even tell it's a sedimentary rock by visual inspection alone. However, these boring rocks are one of the main reservoirs of carbon on Earth. And on geologic timescales, they are the main mechanism for regulating CO2 in the atmosphere. Each year, about 2.5 billion tons of carbon is transferred from the atmosphere to the deep ocean, where it can be locked away in calcite and limestone for hundreds of millions of years. If humans vanished from the Earth tomorrow, geoscientists estimate it would take up to a few hundred thousand years to rebalance the carbon level and allow for excess carbon dioxide to be naturally sequestered in the oceans. That's too long for humans to wait, but a few hundred thousand years is a blink of the eye on a geologic timescale. Capitan Reef itself thrived for several million years, and even has a geologic age named after it, the Capitanian stage, which is part of the Guadalupean epic. Nothing lasts forever though, and Capitan Reef eventually died when the Delaware Basin started to dry up. Due to sea level lowering and sedimentation, the channel connecting the Delaware Basin to the sea was cut off and the basin became an enormous evaporating pond. The evaporating water left behind various salts, including chloride and sulfate minerals, collectively called evaporite minerals. The rocks these minerals make up are also called evaporites. Behind siliciclastics and carbonates, evaporites are the third most common type of sedimentary rock on Earth. The evaporites in the Delaware Basin are called the Castile Formation, which is about 600 meters thick, the same height as the reef because it filled up the basin to the rim, to the reef top.
Top of the reef, here I come!
The Castile is famous for its finely laminated, alternating dark and light layers that can be traced across the basin for over 100 kilometers. These layers are varves, which are alternating layers of sediment deposited annually or seasonally.
Season's greetings!
The light layers in the Castile are evaporite minerals deposited during the dry season as the basin dried out. The dark brown layers are organic and carbonate-rich mud layers deposited during the wet season when the water in the basin was fresher and phytoplankton populations bloomed and then died. Geologists have gone to heroic efforts to count and analyze all of the tiny varve layers, almost 300,000 of them. And the data contained in each layer provides an incredibly high-resolution record of the paleoclimatic and hydrologic conditions in the basin. If you want to know what the water temperature was and how hard the wind was blowing in the winter of 250 million BCE, geologists have got you covered. Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.